There is no secret that women are historically facing greater barriers than men when it comes to participating in the economy across geographies and income levels. Disparities between men and women persist in the form of pay gaps, uneven opportunities for advancement, and an unbalanced representation in important decision-making, aka leadership. What is the reason that is holding back women from achieving a high position? A major question that is always raised when it comes to the topic of women in Islam, when it's debated, does Islam promote or forbid women from achieving high positions? Joining us tonight, and once again, Sayed Hussein Al-Qazwini to discuss this topic and linking it to tonight's topic, which is Fatima, the leader. Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the fourth episode of Zahra the Great with me, your host, Ahmed Ali. Assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina.
Alaikum assalamu wa rahmatullahi.
Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Now, before we begin, for the dear viewers who are just tuning in, if you would like to view the previous episodes, you can visit our YouTube channel at Imam Hussein 3 TV. Sayyidina, in the previous episodes, we talked about Fatima the daughter, Fatima the mother, Fatima the wife. And tonight, after discussing the show, you wanted to mention, or do you want to name the title of this episode, Fatima the leader? What is your intention? What do you mean behind that? What did Fatima al-Zahra contribute? What did she do?
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله.
There is no doubt that Fatima al-Zahra عليه السلام, although the period in which her role was featured, mm-hmm. and she had the spotlight was on her, was several weeks. Mm-hmm. If we take from the death of Rasulullah till her martyrdom, and there's three narrations on her martyrdom.
Yeah.
One is the 40th, meaning 40 days after the demise of the Prophet. Another narration states 75 days. Another narration states 95 days.
95, which are commemorating.
Which we're commemorating now. Yes. Let's take the 95-day narration. 95 days means 3 months and 5 days.
Yes.
Fatima al-Zahra was under the spotlight for 3 months and five days. No doubt that she did have a leadership role. Mm-hmm. Her leadership, you know, isn't the leadership of men, as in entering battlefields, leading an army, becoming an army general, or the head of state, head of government. Usually when you hear that a man has become a leader, mm-hmm. you immediately think that he's the head of a tribe, the head of a government, the head of an army, and so mm-hmm. on and so forth. No. Fatima al-Zahra was none of the above. However, the role that she played, and her role started from the demise of Rasulullah, the same day, from the day of his burial, from the day of the attack on her house, her role began. Mm-hmm. Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam had several achievements. One was after the physical attack on her house, and this is in several narrations,
yes.
in Sunni, let alone Shia yes. narrations. Of course, the Sunni narrations do not discuss the actual attack.
Yes.
Sunni narrations, they stop short. They admit to the bringing of wood yes. and fire.
Burning the door.
They admit to that some of the Sahaba threatened to burn yes. the house. We'll talk about these things yes. tomorrow. They admit to many of these things, but they stop short from actually admitting that the house was attacked. Anyhow, Fatima al-Zahra comes out to the masjid when Amir al-Mu'mineen was dragged to give bay'ah to Abu Bakr. Fatima al-Zahra followed them. She could have stayed at home. She was injured. Physically, she was injured.
Yeah.
She had to stay home. Rather, she left with her injury. She came to the masjid to defend Imam Ali alayhi salam. She was afraid for his life. And she spoke very harsh words towards the Sahaba, that you do this, and I'm the daughter of Rasulullah, and Rasulullah is, his grave is still
wet
from burial.
Yeah.
This was one of the first positions. This was a strong position against the authority at the time. Another very well-known position that Fatima Al-Zahra took was the incident of the speech of Fadik. Fadik was taken. Perhaps we might talk about this
tomorrow
night. When Fadik was taken, Fatima Al-Zahra came to the masjid.
Mm-hmm.
And in front of all the men, of course, she was fully covered. She was fully covered with full hijab. Some say that there was a curtain stopping her stopping men from seeing her. Others say, no, there was no curtain, but she was fully covered. And she gave one of the most powerful political speeches of all time. It was a political speech. It was about Fadik, but she turned it into something a lot bigger than Fadik.
Mm-hmm.
A lot bigger than Fadik. Because as one of the imams, one of the later imams, was asked, how big is Fadik? One of the khulafa of Bani Umayyah asked one of our later imams. He told me, tell me the dimensions of Fadik. He thought it's a, you know, it's a land.
It's like a garden.
It's like a garden. He told him, do you want the, you know, the numbers, or do you want the real size of Fadik? He said, no, give me the real size of Fadik. The imam told him, Fadik starts from China up to Morocco, from Samarkand to... The imam basically gave him the dimensions of the Islamic Ummah. He told him, this is Fadik. Meaning, this is the real Fadik. Our argument is not on a piece of land called Fadik. The actual Fadik is the Khilafah. You see? It's the leadership of the Muslims.
I got lost, because many narrations state that it's a piece of land.
It is a piece of land. It is a piece of land. But what Fatima Al-Zahra was actually arguing over was not a piece of land.
Was the leadership.
Was the leadership. Was the Khilafah. Why? Because Fatima Al-Zahra saw that if she remains quiet on a piece of land, you know, she has to remain quiet on everything else. She had to make it a big deal. Her point was not about Fadik. Because Fatima Al-Zahra saw this, that today I will argue over Fadik. If I receive Fadik, tomorrow I'll argue over the Khilafah. I'll argue over the Khilafah. So Fatima Al-Zahra's philosophy was that let's do this in stages.
So technically she meant the land.
Technically she meant the land, but her objective was much bigger.
Yes.
Was much bigger.
Mm-hmm.
In that speech, it was a very powerful speech. In Arabia, in the Arabian Peninsula, in that area, women were, they were deprived of all rights.
Yeah, buried.
They were buried. They were abused physically, emotionally. They had no rights. They
enslaved.
They were enslaved. Their inheritance would be taken.
Yes.
You know, all kinds of exploitation would occur with women.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, you have a young lady come inside the masjid in front of a lot of men, in front of an authority that just usurped power, and she stands without any fear to speak, and speaks so eloquently. Fatima Al-Zahra, it's not like she sat and she memorized a speech. No, it was impromptu. It was impromptu, and she gave the most powerful speech. That you say that my father had stated that prophets, whatever they leave, is charity? The Quran says, وَوَرَثَ سُلَيْمَانُ دَاوُودُ.
There's no inheritance for the prophets.
The Quran says, that Dawood inherited, Sulaiman inherited Dawood. Zakaria says, وَهَبْنِي مِنْ لَدُنْكَ وَلِيَّا يَرِثُنِي وَيَرِثُ مِنْ آلِ يَعْقُوبِ.
Yes.
Grant me a son that will inherit me. What you're saying contradicts the Quran. You, Ya Aba Bakr, you inherit your father, but I don't inherit my father?
Wow.
These are powerful words. And this shows the beauty of Islam. Because if it wasn't for Islam elevating women and giving them rights and giving them their privileges, Fatima Al-Zahra would not have been able to speak in such a way. But because she knew that through the message of her father and through the message of the Quran and through the work of 23 years, Rasulullah had worked so much to elevate the status of women,
mm-hmm.
that Fatima Al-Zahra could speak freely.
Mm-hmm.
And she couldn't be... This is leadership.
Mm-hmm.
This was Fatima Al-Zahra's leadership. Words.
Okay.
To come and speak in front of these usurpers of Khilafah, this is definitely, to me, this is leadership.
Mm-hmm. I mean, according to some, to many, they say that Fatima Al-Zahra is an infallible. She built her courageousness, if you will, from her infallibility. So she was able to do that. We don't see any women in the history of Islam other than Fatima Al-Zahra and Zainab alayhi salam who actually play the leadership position, if you will, after the demise of Rasulullah and after the martyrdom of Hussein in Karbala. We see Fatima Al-Zahra and Lady Zainab. We don't see any women.
In the history of Islam?
In the history
of
Islam.
Or in general?
After, if she set that role model, why is it only her?
First of all, I disagree. We see
it though. I mean, it's history.
Right. First of all, we have other examples,
mm-hmm.
of figures that made political statements. For example, like Asiya, the wife of Fir'aun. طيب.
And she wasn't Muslim, although she followed Prophet Moses. But she...
From our history... Well, first of all, we have to realize that this is a male-dominated society.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't easy for them to accept the equality between men and women.
Mm-hmm.
These are people that took women, they enslaved their women. Their women were basically prisoners,
mm-hmm.
at home. They couldn't leave the house. They were treated the same way that a slave is treated. They were killed, infanticide, right? So first of all, you have to acknowledge this, that this was a male-dominated society.
Mm-hmm.
But despite that, we see several female figures. One, Umm Samaka. Who is this?
Mm-hmm.
I believe right now, if I haven't mistaken her name, or her name is Umm Samaka, a female from the Sahaba, from the companions of Rasulullah, who was at the Battle of Uhud.
She fought.
When all of the companions of the Prophet left him except four men, and she was the fifth. Except five people. Four men and one female, and she was one of them. She took a stick and wanted to defend Rasulullah. And she defended Rasulullah. She came in the battlefield to defend Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As a female figure. We have some companions of Rasulullah, some of the Sahabiyat, who would come to the battles, but not to fight, to nurse. You know, they say that Islam tells a woman to sit at home and not leave the house. Rasulullah would take some woman with him to battle, but not to enter the battlefield, to nurse the men. This was their jihad. The jihad of men was to fight. The jihad of women was to nurse those who were injured. This is leadership. They could have stayed at home,
yeah.
but they decided to listen to Rasulullah and go out. Some of the wives of Rasulullah were in great leadership positions. Khadija alayhi salam. If it wasn't for her wealth and her leadership, Islam would have been in danger. Umm Salama. You know, we rarely talk about some of the other wives,
mm-hmm.
of Rasulullah. Some of the other pious wives of Rasulullah. Umm Salama was one of the great wives of Rasulullah. She was knowledgeable. Sometimes she would answer questions. They would come to her to ask her questions, and she would ask. She would answer questions based on her knowledge of the Quran and her knowledge of the traditions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and some of the others. So, but why don't we see more? You have to remember, it was a male-dominated society. Women were not comfortable to coming out and being in leadership positions.
Mm-hmm.
It's not because Islam did not give them the opportunity, but because it was a male-dominated society.
Mm-hmm. Now, one of the questions that is raised and that comes to my mind is that, you know, over the past few decades, and, you know, after many debates and many protests on the streets, women in the West have been given a chance, a small chance to lead. You can't say a chance, because a chance may have limits, may not have limits. A very small chance to lead. We see people like Hillary Clinton. We see like Theresa May.
And Angela Merkel.
Now, these are a few out of how many leaders we have around the world. Does Islam give women the opportunity to lead? This is a very sensitive topic. I mean, a lot of people in debates, as you mentioned, wherever you go, wherever the topic is, women in Islam, this question has to be raised.
Right.
Why are Muslim women always in the house? Why don't they leave? Why don't they, you know, work? They do work, but, you know, some people are, they're blind, or I don't know, their ego blinds them. I don't know. But this question is always raised. Does Islam give opportunities to women to lead, or are they ordered to be followers?
It's true. Today in the West, you'll find female politicians in Germany, in the UK. It was almost going to happen in the US. There have been female politicians that reached power, or some were almost going to reach power. The West gave them that opportunity. Supposedly in the West, there's no, you know, gender barriers. A woman could reach wherever a man reached. However, you have to remember that this didn't happen a long time ago. In the US,
a couple of decades ago,
yeah, women were given the right to vote. They didn't have the right to vote. In the UK, less than 150 years ago, women did not have the right to ownership. They couldn't own. It's only been 150 years ago that in the UK, women are able to own, and the US women are able to vote, and, you know, they were given these rights. These rights didn't exist before.
I mean, some people will debate Islam has been 1400 years.
Islam has given these rights. Islam has given these rights. We, you know, should differentiate between what Islam has given women and what have Muslims given women, because they're not the same.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes to Islam, Islam has given women the right to ownership from day one. Women can own. In fact, we have, you know, laws stating that a man has absolutely no authority, a husband has no authority to touch the wealth of his wife.
Mm-hmm.
Even if she's richer than him, he has to spend. She doesn't have to spend on the family. She doesn't even have to spend on herself. The husband has to spend on her. That means she can own. She has the right to own homes, lands, wealth, businesses. Sayyidina Khadija was a
businesswoman.
She was a businesswoman. Rasulullah needed her for a loan. And then it was actually mudaraba. It wasn't loan. It was profit sharing. Anyhow, so Islam has given women the right to own, to work. We don't have a single law that states women are not allowed to work and not allowed to enter the workforce. In fact, in the West, when women enter the workforce, when was it? Historians tell us that when women entered the labor force, it was after World War One. World War One, they entered the factories. Why? Because so many men, millions of men, had joined the war.
Yeah.
These factories needed workers,
yeah,
and they needed cheap labor. They brought women. These women were exploited.
Yes.
One, they would work more hours than men did. Two, they were paid less than men were paid. Mm-hmm. And when men, after World War I, when many men came back, these women lost their jobs. They lost their jobs. This is exploitation. And those who remained at work, they weren't able to receive promotions. And even this exists till today. Mm-hmm. Till today in sociology, mm-hmm. we learn about the glass ceiling.
Yeah.
A woman, a man and a woman in the same company, in the same, you know, workplace, the man has more chances of receiving a promotion than the woman. Why? Because a woman might get pregnant, mm-hmm. she might get married, get pregnant, and have a child, she'll have to leave the work. So men, so these companies, they think, they assume that having a man is more productive than having a woman. They'll give him mm-hmm. the promotion, but not the woman.
Mm-hmm. Can we continue this but after a short break?
Absolutely.
If you want, inshallah.
Absolutely.
Respected viewers, do stay tuned for after the break. We'll continue our discussion. Stay tuned. Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Once again, I welcome you to the second part of tonight's episode where me and my dear guest, Sayed Hussein Al-Qazwini, have been talking about achieving a high leadership position for women in Islam or in general. Welcome, Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you very much. Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Before the break, we touched upon a few key points, and we touched upon, you know, the Islamic history and the viewpoint of women being in leadership. And we also touched upon some of the things that have been going on through history that just up to a few decades ago were solved. The being in the workforce for women and them getting and the pay wage, the gap between men and women is huge. A study that was done in 2015 says out of the top 500 companies, Fortune companies around the world, especially in America, 21 women out of 500 actually became CEOs of that. So the ratio is huge. So we find that, you know, even today, I mean, 2015 was just 2 years ago. So today we find that, you know, such ideas still exists. Yet I'm going to ask you the question again. Does Islam provide women, Muslim women, the opportunity to work or be in a leadership position?
Absolutely, absolutely. First of all, going back to the wage gap, in Islam there's no such thing as wage gap. Islam says you respect a person's work, regardless of who they are.
I mean, for inheritance, there is.
For inheritance. Inheritance is another issue. Inheritance is another issue. But when it comes to wages, Islam says we respect a person's actions, regardless of who they are. If they perform an action, they deserve that wage, whether it's a man or a woman. Just because this person's a man, it doesn't mean that he should earn more than a woman. All the jobs, all the professions, Islam, wherever men reached, women can also reach. This is not something...
Has this been proven religiously, Islamically?
There's nothing in Islam that stops women. Has this been implemented? That's our fault. Uh-huh. That's the fault of Muslims. But we're talking about Islam now. Islam doesn't prevent. If men can become doctors and engineers and scientists, and politicians, women can too. Wherever men reached, women have reached. we'll go a step further. Some jurists, not just today,
please don't tell me they're leading.
You know, over 400 years ago, Al-Muqaddas Al-Ardabili, Al-Muqaddas Ahmed Al-Ardabili, who was in Najaf, his date of death is 993, I believe, after Hijrah. We're 1438 after Hijrah. His year of death is 993. Over 400 years ago. Over 400 years ago. In his book, his major compendium on fiqh, Majma' al-Fa'idati wal-Burhan, he talks about judges, and who is qualified to be a judge, and what are the conditions of being a judge. Do you have to be a male? So he says that most scholars believe that you have to be a male to be a judge. And he says, well, let's see what proof they have. He talks about the proof, and he says, this isn't proof. This isn't proof. This is not evidence. This is weak. This does not prove to me that women cannot be judges. And then he reaches the final conclusion that women can be judges in Islam, in courts, as long as they fulfill other conditions, such as being a mujtahid, having the ability to derive an Islamic law, they're religious, all the other conditions, a woman could become a judge. Today, there are contemporary scholars in Iran and Iraq that believe women can become judges. There have some that even went further to say we do not have proof, sufficient proof to stop women from becoming maraja. For example, a Sheikh Muhammad Hussein Al-Isfahani, also known as Al-Kumpani Al-Isfahani, one of the teachers of Sayyid Al-Khoi. And we're talking about 150 years ago. 100 years ago. 100 years ago. He said this 100 years ago, that we don't have sufficient proof to stop women from becoming miraj. Sayyid Muhsin al-Hakim. This was his opinion, that we don't have sufficient proof to stop women from being maraja. If they have studied, they are capable of giving an opinion, an educated opinion on matters of Islamic law, we'll take it from them. Just like we refer to a female doctor and a female engineer, we refer to female experts and professionals, we may refer to them in Islamic law as well.
Mm-hmm. I mean, so
this is a turning point. This is a huge step.
Men can follow female jurists.
No, I'm not here to issue a fatwa. I'm telling you such discussions exist.
Exist, but when, for example, if I make a point, you know, for the dear viewers, we have to clarify. And for example, if say for right now, a woman came out and declared her scholarship. She says from now on, and
most scholars say you can't follow her. Mm-hmm. Most. But I'm saying that there are. Mm-hmm. You will find some discussions.
For females, or can she be for females or no?
Well, if she could be, she could be for everyone.
Oh.
Not just females. Mm-hmm. In fact, in the biography of Shahid al-Awwal, Shamsuddin Muhammad ibn Makki, Shahid al-Awwal from Lebanon, he had his wife and his daughter. His daughter, Fatima Sitt al-Mashayikh. Mm-hmm. This was her name, Fatima Sitt al-Mashayikh. Shahid al-Awwal, she was a jurist. She was a mujtahida. Al-Hurr al-Amili, in his book Amal al-Amil, when he talks about Fatima Sitt al-Mashayikh, he says she was a mujtahida. Her father would ask women, he would say, don't refer to me. You don't even need to ask me questions. Ask my daughter questions.
Wow.
He would get women to refer to her. This is leadership. And his wife, meaning her mother, Ali. Mm-hmm. His wife, Ali, was also a jurist. Al-Shahid al-Awwal would ask women to refer to her. I remember once I did a study and I came across at least 15 female mujtahids in our history. At least
15.
Those that I came across. There's many that I don't know about. Mujtahids, they reached this position, this academic level of knowledge. Mm-hmm. Islam doesn't stop women from becoming leaders. Islam does not put a barrier on women. إنما إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم من عمل صالحا من ذكر وأنثى فلنحيينه حياة طيبة. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not discriminate between men and women. All the opportunities that are laid down for men, they are laid down for women as well. Yes, there are some details, there are some differences on the issue of inheritance, on the issue of witnessing. Even those are debated today. Even those are debated. It's not a discrimination. When Islam says that a woman's testimony is half of that of a man, it's not because of discrimination against her. No. There's a special context. These laws have to be contextualized. The verse that speaks of a woman's testimony is half of that of a man, it's a verse that discusses financial issues, seeking out a loan, buying and selling. Usually women, because they don't pay it back then, today it might be a different case. Mm-hmm. Back then, because women did not deal so much with money, usually it's the man that buys and sells, they might not remember, especially numbers. How much did you buy? How much did you sell? This is something normal. People remember the things that pertain to them the most. Ask about, talk about the stock market. Even today, who will tell you if stocks went up or down? Men or women? Usually it's the men, right? Women tend to remember the things that pertain to them. Men remember the things that pertain to them. This is something normal, right? Islam says that if a woman witnessed, let her have another witness. Why? Because she might forget. أن تظل أحداهما فتذكر أحداهما الأخرى. The verse says, it's not a matter of discrimination against women. It's a matter of memory. Who remembers better on this topic, matters of money, business, loans. You bought this, you bought that, or you bought this, you sold that. For how much?
I mean,
it's not a discrimination. It's not an issue of discrimination.
Mm-hmm. After all the development that the world went through, is there a need? I mean, for example, for business or money, there's receipts, there's bank statements, there's various ways you can go about proving something that is right or wrong.
Right.
You still would, I need another woman.
For example, in Sharia al-Islam, al-Muhaqqiq al-Hilli, he says that if you owe me money, and I only have one witness, and she's a female, he says that's fine. One female witness, and I have to swear that you owe me money, that's enough. One female witness plus swearing by God that you owe me, that's enough. That's enough. Today, there's a lot of developments. Of course, there's a lot of reform in Islamic fiqh, and there's a lot of laws that were previously accepted and were popular. Today they're being reassessed and they're being revised. My point is that women can be leaders.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a single fatwa that says a woman cannot be a president or a prime minister or a minister or a member of parliament or the head of a committee. No. We don't have any such laws.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have such narrations that say women cannot participate in, in civic engagement, in civic leadership, in politics. No.
Mm-hmm.
Islam has given women that opportunity. But have they taken the opportunity? That's another issue.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm afraid that women, for so many centuries, they've got used to being followers, that today it's difficult for them to become leaders. Because when you get used to something, it's hard to change.
Mm-hmm.
It's like we, the Shia of Iraq, for centuries, we've always been ruled, oppressed, and not the rulers, that today that government has finally come into our hands. We don't know how to rule because we've been used to being ruled. And I think it's the same case with women. There's not a lot of women coming out to lead mm-hmm. because they've been used to being led. And to follow.
Mm-hmm.
So to be followed is something new to them.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope that women will take advantage of Islam's rights for them,
mm-hmm.
Islam's designated rights for them, to achieve.
Mm-hmm. Over the past half a decade, this is speaking in general, not specific Muslims or other races or religions. Over the past half decade, a lot of talk has been about a topic where do we need more women leaders? Would it affect our society? What does society have to change in order to produce more women leaders, female leaders? And as studies after being conducted, they see that women are more fit than men in some areas, in some fields.
Right.
In your opinion, do we need female leaders? What can they achieve? What can they contribute to Islam or to, in general, for the general community or society?
I think we do need female leaders. Not just because, we're not giving into pressure to the feminist movements or so on and so forth. No. I truly believe, and there's many scholars today that feel the same way, that women have a lot to contribute. You see, men and women are different, not just physically, but even the way they think.
Mm-hmm.
Women will notice things that men don't. I don't know if you've noticed this or not. If a man and a woman were to enter a gathering where there's a lot of men and women, they're socializing, men will notice certain things while women will notice other things. You can tell from their discussions when they go back home. Did you see this person or that person or what this person was wearing or what was on this thing? A man might not, pay attention to these things. The man might pay attention to the food at the gathering,
mm-hmm.
while women will pay attention to the details, the colors, the painting of, the color of the paint in the room, so on and so forth. The man will pay attention to the weather. It was really hot in there, while women will pay attention to other things. My point is that men and women think differently. In leadership, we need that other perspective. We need women to come and give us their perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a male-dominated society. We men think, we've always thought in a specific way, and we've ruled, men generally have ruled according to their understanding.
Mm-hmm.
But when a woman comes and gives her input on what she thinks, how she thinks, I think it will make a difference. Whether we're talking about in the field of politics or the field of religion. Even in religion, if we allow women to give their input after reaching a stage of knowledge, becoming jurists or becoming mujtahida, if they put their input and they say, from this narration, I understand something else. While many men will read a narration and they'll get one thing from it, if a woman were to read it, she might understand something else. We could learn from that perspective.
Yes.
If we give the chance for women, I'm not talking about marja'iyya, no. But if we give them a chance to research, if we give them a chance to teach, if we give them a chance to write in journals, to write articles, to write books about Islamic law, about any, we can learn from their perspective.
Definitely.
They'll have something new to offer.
Definitely.
And the same thing goes for politics. That's one. Another point that I'd like to make is that women they're not aggressive by nature. Men are aggressive. That's why you see men, they like action movies, movies that are full of action and blood and, Women, on the other hand, they like romance, they like drama, things like that. Movies in that sort of genre.
Mm.
This shows that women are not aggressive. They're not violent. We need that in politics. We need non-violence in our politics. We need non-aggression in our politics. When a woman comes and gives her perspective and calms things down. We need that into politics.
Definitely.
Not just into politics. Our Islamic centers in the West, even here, women don't have roles in mosques and Islamic centers. Very few. We only need them when we want to fundraise, because women are excellent at fundraising. But when it comes to decision making, on the future of our Islamic centers, on our majalis, which speakers to bring in, which sort of programs to have, we don't give women their role. Even though when you go to some mosques and Husseiniyat and Islamic centers, you will find that women are more than the men. In the audience, you will find women are maybe 60% or 70%, while men make up of 30% or 40% of the audience. This is a common feature in a lot of places where I go. They make up more than half of the audience, but they don't have a say in decision making. This is not fair.
Mm-hmm.
This is wrong. We need to give women their place in the community, in politics, in religion, in all fields.
Mm-hmm.
And I strongly feel that women, they can contribute a lot. There's a lot, they can contribute so much positive contributions they can make, but we just need to give them that opportunity.
Yes, hopefully we can, through, it takes something, a huge thing to change within the mentality of whether Muslims or any population,
right,
and society, to give the segregated segment of society the chance to actually breathe.
Islam did it. Islam gave that opportunity to Sayyidah Khadija, to Fatima al-Zahra alayha salam, to Sayyidah Zainab, and to other females.
Yes.
Why can't we do the same
today?
Yes,
and it's unfortunate to see that how Muslims cherry-picked out of the religion. They cherry-picked what they want and left what's actually more beneficial for the religion. But I would like to thank you very much for joining us tonight.
My pleasure.
Inshallah, tomorrow we'll continue our discussion on Fatima the martyr,
inshallah.
Thank you very much once again. Respected viewers, one key point that we should leave and conclude with tonight is to always keep an open mind on what is actually prohibited and what is actually promoted for Muslim women in Islam. Thank you very much for joining us tonight. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ahsantum.